I've installed quite a few solar and battery systems on houses over the past few years, and my favorite by far is the stackable EcoFlow Delta Pro Ultra, especially now that they have a car charger that can charge an EV using only excess solar electricity. The easy part is plugging in that charger, the harder part is building the net that catches sunshine. These four boxes allow us to perpetually charge an EV without ever paying for electricity. Technically, we can get the job done with just two of them, but we can talk about that later. The cost of electricity here in Utah is a pretty cheap 12 cents per kilowatt hour, but by comparison, electricity in California is about 35 cents. And going further west, it's 41 cents per kilowatt hour in places like Hawaii. But Texas still wins with the highest price of $9 per kilowatt hour when storms roll in. That price is an outlier, of course, with only the heaviest of storms, but it also kind of proves why energy independence is so important. Each of the stackable modules in EcoFlow's battery system is 6 kilowatt hours, and can be daisy-chained together in up to 3 stacks for a mind-blowing 90 kilowatt hours worth of energy. The batteries clip together like very heavy Legos, since each of them weighs about 116 pounds. The inverter on top weighs about 70. And even if the batteries are completely drained every day for 10 years straight, they would still have about 80% of their original capacity left. Lithium-ion batteries are pretty awesome. Installing the solar panels is a very DIY-able part of the project. Even obtaining permits, if your city requires them, is simple enough. I got all of my solar panels and racking equipment from a company called Solar Wholesale. They take a look at your house and the system you're trying to power and give you everything you need in one nice little kit. I'll leave a link down in the description. There's two solar inputs on the battery, the EcoFlow Delta Pro Ultra. We're putting 10 panels on the side of the house that faces east so it can catch all the electricity in the sunrise. And then we're putting the low voltage array, which is 1600 watts, on the west side. So as the sun is setting, they're still getting solar energy. And it's cool that we're able to use both sides of the house to get, you know, more energy obtained throughout the day. A full sunrise to sunset system. The hardest part of laying out the solar array is figuring out where the feet go. The feet we're using today is from Snap and Rack. This is their Ultra Foot. It comes pre-installed with some polybutylene tape on the bottom, which means we don't have to add any sealant later. The channel on the back of the foot is to raise and lower to compensate for any fluctuations that might be there with the plywood roofing. Not all roofs are entirely level, but the solar array will be. And the gap between the panels and the shingles allows for more airflow, because the cooler the panels are during the summer, the more efficient they run. These are a deck mount system, meaning we don't have to find joists, but it's always a good idea to find them anyway, just for some extra security. To find a joist, you can just take a hammer and you can hear the hollow spots under the plywood, but the tone gets more solid once you're on top of a joist. And that's where we're setting the feet. The planset calls for the feet to be every 48 inches, and we're offsetting them with each other so that the feet on one rail aren't attached to the same joist as the feet on the other rail. We also like 1 foot to be relatively close to the end of the rail, making sure not more than 1/3 of the solar panel overhangs the foot. It all starts coming together once you look at the planset, which, if you went through solarwholesale.com, that planset is included along with all of the solar equipment. The reason we have the copper grounding wire running from each of the rails is primarily just another level of safety. Grounding provides a low resistance path for any excess electricity or malfunctions or faults or lightning strikes, dissipating any excess energy so it doesn't cause damage to the house or humans. We'll tie the grounding wire into the electrical panel, which already has a connection with the earth ground of the house. You'll have to do the math for your own situation, of course, but here in Utah, this 5.6 kilowatt hours worth of solar will generate about 30 kilowatt hours of energy a day. And assuming I use all that energy through my house, or charging an EV, or Bitcoin mining, if you're into that kind of thing, the batteries will pay themselves off in electricity generation in about 3 years. During a Texas snowstorm, of course, the battery would pay for itself in about 15 days. Obviously, the solar panels and smart home panel too cost a bit more, but they do allow the Delta Pro Ultra system to take your house off grid, which is pretty priceless. The sealant is here to keep any water from going down inside of the attic, and we have the piece of conduit to protect the wires as it comes into the easy solar box. And also, do not touch this black stuff or it will stay on your fingers forever.
The Delta Pro Ultra does charge and discharge down to a negative 4 degrees Fahrenheit and can handle a heat wave up to 113 degrees. And don't get me wrong, it's still definitely a buy once, cry once kind of situation, but it's still cheaper than the other guys, especially since it does not require a specialized installer. Any electrician can handle the essential loads panel.
So inside this box, we have the grounding wires connected together. Then we have solar leads coming out the bottom side of it with the MC4 connectors. The female one's already wired into the panels, and the panels are wired in series, one connected to each other all the way up here, making sure we stay under that 400 volts. And then the last panel, which is going right where I'm sitting, is going to connect into the male right here, go into the attic, out through the soffit, which we drilled earlier, all the way down into the battery. And since we are tucked under the shingle and have that watertight sealant underneath, any water that comes down from the roof above will just flow around the box, down the roof, into the gutter. That is it for the roof. We have the high voltage array and the low voltage array over here. Now let's get the sun juice connected to the battery. The low voltage plug on the Ultra has this kind of port to it. And so we're taking the MC4s, this cable was included with the Ultra. We're taking the MC4s and just splicing it back into the wire that came out of our conduit. Going into the low voltage port, and we should be seeing some input here. So we did switch this switch to on, and then it has low voltage registering. There we go, 500 watts, not bad. 600, it's a little cloudy today, but on a peak day, we should see closer to 13, give or take. Nice, we're juicing up. We are ready for the high voltage, so I'm going to turn this back off and then plug in the high voltage wires. And now we're detecting both arrays, which is awesome. Voltage is creeping up, and so it's combining both the low voltage and high voltage now. But remember, the high voltage is facing, it's probably 5 o'clock in the afternoon right now. But even then, the high voltage is still getting about 1,000 watts. Not bad. The smart home panel 2 in this box isn't mandatory for the battery or solar panels to function, but it is important if you want to integrate the battery with the circuit breakers already built into your house. This essential loads panel splits into two pieces for easier installation. This is going to go on the wall right there to connect to the battery, and this needs to go next to the control panel, which is all the way upstairs.
Every home is different, and they're not all built for solar installations. For example, this house has their breaker panel installed on the second floor, which is why we had to go up into the roof, punch out through the soffit, and run conduit down the side of the house. But now that we're upstairs, we can install the EcoFlow Smart Home Panel 2.
Out with the old, in with the new.
The Smart Home Panel 2 is what's going to allow us to choose essential loads off the main breaker panel and make sure that they're first in line to receive solar power and a battery backup.
Cool thing about the original breaker panel is that it is exactly 14 and a quarter inches, and the same thing over here on this panel. It's supposed to be inlaid between the two studs, so it's not sticking out the full width of the panel.
If the contractors who framed your house were good at their job, the Smart Home Panel 2 will slot right in between the studs. In our case, though, we have to perform a technical maneuver called kerfing, or cutting the stud lengthwise, to give us an extra few millimeters to slot the box in. Setting up an essential loads panel is probably one of the things you most likely won't want to tackle yourself. A certified electrician can probably do it in half the time.
We have successfully kerfed this edge. Control panel going in, EcoFlow Smart Home 2. It. That's cool. Obviously, it's built for 2x6 walls. These are 2x4, so it's going to stick out a tiny bit. Now we just need to move the essential circuits from here into here. The smart panel.
The Ultra can output 7.6 kilowatts, which means we just have to make sure that the loads that we're putting on this panel will never be more than 7.6 kilowatts if they were all to run at the same time. The panel is intelligent enough, though, that if the loads ever did exceed what the battery's able to handle, it would just immediately kick off to the grid like a UPS system. UPS means an uninterrupted power supply, meaning that the Smart Home Panel 2 can transition between battery power and grid power with a 0 millisecond response time, which is ideal for sensitive electronics, they won't even know that the power is switched and is coming from a different source. Since we just installed a ton of solar though, ideally that is where we'd get our power from.
Might look fairly chaotic right now, but it's actually the best time to explain what's going on. So this is the older, this is the dumb panel that we're moving breakers over to the smart panel. We've already filled it with the breakers that were previously over here. The smart panel's getting power from a few different places. We have the battery, you know, the same cord that we wrapped in from the ceiling coming from the battery that goes around this panel into the bottom where that box used to be. Then we also have power coming in from the grid, which is this breaker here. The dumb panel has its power coming in from the grid going to this breaker, and this breaker comes out and feeds the smart panel. So the smart panel can switch between the grid and the battery instantly. The smart panel also has a generator input, which we are not going to be using in this particular project. When we took the breakers out of here and put them over here, the wires weren't quite long enough, so we're going to wire nut the extensions, bring them out the bottom of the panel over the side, we'll replace this drywall later, and then bring the wires up into this panel where this smart panel can control each of the breakers individually. Obviously, this is extremely dangerous, especially if the panels are live, so I highly recommend doing this with a certified electrician. Luckily, though, cleanup is super easy. Guys, that didn't work. And from the outside, it looks incredibly premium, especially when compared with the old style. This has a glass door, which is pretty premium. Then we have all the breakers that we moved over from this panel. We put blanks in where the old ones used to be. There we go.
Obviously, the primary goal is to have everything running on battery and solar all the time, but if it's cloudy for a few days or there's snow on the panels, the smart home panel too will just switch back to the grid instantly. My parents have been running this same system for about a year now, and they probably already forgot it exists with how low maintenance it is. This is an off-grid system though, so if the battery completely charges up, the solar will just stop working since none of it's gonna flow out to the grid.
Now that we have the battery connected to solar, my favorite part and the recent addition that EcoFlow has done to the Ultra setup is add an EV charger that can charge up an electric vehicle using only excess solar energy, which is something I've been wanting for a long time because obviously you get an EV to save on gas, and now if you have solar, you just don't even pay for electricity at all and you're driving your electric car for free, which is pretty amazing. It's the EcoFlow PowerPulse EV Charger, and it can charge at 9 kilowatts. Assuming, of course, you have that much power and or pull from the grid and or pull from the battery. It all depends on just how fast you need to charge, but most people, like if you're home for the weekend and you don't have to go to work, you can just trickle charge with the sun and be fully charged, you know, by the time you go to work on Monday. Plus, the mounting requires no wiring or no electrician because it's just this single plug, the same plug that the battery uses to connect to the smart home panel too. And then you have a 25-foot J1772, which works for the Rivians, the Fords, and the Chevys. And of course, you can get an adapter to work with the Teslas, the NACS port. Plus, the cable's like 25 feet long, so we're installing it here on this outlet because Riley usually parks his truck right here on the outside, and then he can just bring it out from the garage, plug it into his car. But it is exterior rated if you do want to mount it outside.
The double-headed screws, so there's slots right here at the back of the EV charger, and then this one has a screw underneath that will cinch down on the bottom screw to hold it tight.
I'm sure the mounting is fine if you're going into like studs, but we sink our top two screws into drywall, so I'm taking this extra metal plate, sliding it behind the charger, and coming right there for a little bit of added support.
Realistically, here in Utah, it'll save me about $15 every time I charge up my truck, but it's the little things that add up to big things over time.
Moment of truth. We currently have a 99% charged battery. Solar is coming in at 4,000 watts because it's completely maxed out. House is pulling 300, and the charger is connected. Let's see what happens when we plug it in. Using only excess solar. And look at that. Instantly, we jump up to 4.4 kilowatts pulling solar in from the roof. And it's cool that it gives it in amps as well as volts. Not that we actually need the amps and volts information. Most people just talk in watts anyway. And then if we look at the battery, we can see that 4,000 is coming in. 47 is going out, probably because it's factoring in what's leaving the house through the battery too. And it's completely passed through since the battery is not moving.
Success. The car is completely charging off of excess solar we have on the roof for free, with a little asterisk since we had to pay to get to this point. But now the house is also backed up for emergencies. We do deplete the one battery in the single stack every single night, so I will probably add a second battery and slot it in as soon as funds allow. But that's the nice thing about it being modular, since it only takes about 60 seconds to add capacity to your stack. If you're ready to take your electrical power back into your own hands, I will leave a link down in the description, and thanks a ton for watching. I'll see you around.